I totally disagree with that, because I think it's if you really take a look at that, the process in which that the Japanese government made a decision to surrender, the atomic bomb was not really the most crucial event, because the first bomb was dropped on August 6th. Second bomb, Nagasaki, that you're interested in, was dropped on August 9th. In between, there's a Soviet entry. And my theory is the Soviet entry has more decisive impact on the Japanese decision. You have to get back a little bit, because I think July 26th, the Potsdam Proclamation was issued. And the Japanese government did not accept it, but did not reject it. The reason is that the Japanese government is trying to terminate the war through the mediation of Moscow. And so the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima. Of course, that created a crisis. And immediately they knew that was that atomic bomb. By the end of the day, that all the news came. But Soviet answer is pending. And so they continue to rely on the Soviet mediation. And when on the Soviet enter the war, then the last hope is really dashed. And then second bomb was dropped, and second bomb had very, very little effect on the Japanese decision. Because the premise on which the Americans decided to drop a bomb and then this will be decisive is based on their assumption that the damage to civilians would inflict tremendous impact, inflict a tremendous damage. Unacceptable to the Japanese government, right? But you see, each government has a priority. Damage to civilian is not really first priority. The first priority for Japanese policymakers, at least, was the preservation of so-called kokutai. Kokutai is a very special term, but kokutai is basically the emperor system. And so that is a very issue that the Japanese policymakers concerned. That's why, Potsdam Proclamation, for instance, was really silent, remained silent on the fate of emperor. And so they said, oh boy, it's not clear. And so they still continue to negotiate with the Soviet government. And so even after the atomic bomb, Hiroshima was bombed, still they are hanging out with this preservation, how to preserve the kokutai, right? You see, the damage, the civilian casualty was not the most important thing that they are concerned about. The United States just wanted to end the war before the Soviets get in. Who's gonna come to the goal first, right? And the Soviet Union wanted to go when they get in before the Japanese government decided to surrender. So those are two very intense reasons. Truman and Burns thought that the atomic bomb would do the job, and well, it turned out that was not. Did not work that well. Just Soviet Union just managed to join the war in the nick of time, and so that was a very decisive factor, I think. When Truman received the first news of successful detonation of atomic bomb in Los Alamos, he wrote in a diary. That's a real time, right? I got big news, atomic bomb successful. And this is an enormous destructive capacity. It is so enormous, so powerful, that the steel tower, 60 feet long, melted. And then immediately, melted, right? And immediately after this, but we are going to use this against a military target. We are a civilized nation. We are not going to use it against women, children. I mean, can you imagine? that the powerful weapon you're going to drop in the middle of the city, you're not going to affect, the women and children. It's already there's the process of denial started even in Truman. That's a very interesting question. The question involves in why the United States issued the Potsdam proclamation, right? And every Truman said, and everybody thought that this is ultimatum, this is the final ultimatum, and we gave the Japanese a chance, right? But if you really analyze Potsdam proclamation, it is there are a couple of very, very funny things. In the first place, if it is the United States already knew the Japanese government approached Moscow and they are on the verge of surrender, decision, right? The second thing is that when the Potsdam Proclamation was given to Truman by Stimson, and Stimson's aides drafted that, there are two things there in the draft. That is, first, the Soviet entry into the war was predicted, right? And that means that the Potsdam Proclamation would have Stalin's signature, right? Second thing is that it included a provision where the United States had promised to the Japanese that if if they accept surrender and they create a democratic government and that will not threaten the world peace, then the Japanese people have a chance to preserve monarchy under the current dynasty, right? When the proclamation was issued, those two provisions were eliminated. Mm. And you have to ask yourself, why? If, Truman wrote in the memoirs that, the decision to drop the bomb was a very, very heavy. I just wanted to avoid. Well, if he wanted to avoid, then why didn't he invite Stalin to sign the proclamation? And when he knew that the Japanese government relied on Moscow, right? And secondly, they knew that the Japanese government desperately wanted to know the fate of the emperor and the emperor system. Why didn't they promise the Japanese government that there's a possibility there, right? And those two alternatives were consciously avoided, and so that's why I think it's I would argue that Potsdam Proclamation when it was issued, it's already decided that they are going to drop them, unless the Japanese government just, gave up and we're going to accept this.
Yeah.
And there's no chance that they would accept it,
yeah,
because there's no promise of emperor and so on. And so if that is so, then why did they issue? They issue so that, in my opinion, this is alibi, so that they can justify the drop,
right,
of the bomb. Before the Japanese, we see that the Japan and the Soviet Union had neutrality pact. Neutrality pact was concluded in April 1941. That was the last 5 years. But one of the provisions is unless one party notified the other 1 year before it's over full term, then the neutrality pact will be automatically renewed. And so April 1945, Soviet government notified Japanese government that we are not going to renew it. And the Japanese ambassador asked Molotov, the foreign commissar, said, does that mean that you're going to abrogate neutrality pact right away? And Molotov said, no, neutrality pact is still in force until April 1946. And on the clock of the neutrality, the Soviet government was frantically sending the troops from Europe to Far East, particularly after German defeat. And later on, when Stalin and had a conversation with Truman, he says, "We have to lull Japanese to sleep." And so that, you know, of course, from Stalin's point of view, it is necessary to delay the Japanese surrender so that the Soviet Union could participate. And Truman also wanted to delay, yeah, so that the United States can drop, you know, could drop the bomb. That's right. Stalin knew that, of course, the Manhattan Project was completely secret, right, confidential. It kept from the Soviet Union. But Stalin had a spy, Soviet spy, Klaus Fuchs and others, and they are feeding information to Stalin. And then they knew that the first atomic experiment would take place. And so that when Truman approached Stalin during the recess of Potsdam Conference, he says, "Mr., we have to have some information, very important information, to tell you that we succeeded in possessing a very a weapon of enormous destructive capacity." That's what it said, without saying atomic bomb. And everybody was watching what Stalin's reaction. Stalin very nonchalantly turned to Truman and said, "I hope that you make a good use of it." And everybody thought, good. You know, Stalin did not catch it. But Stalin knew exactly, and he went back to the official resident. He just talked about this, and we are not going to be fooled. But what he did not expect was the United States was so quick to use the bomb. I think that's something that he did not expect. And so that when a bomb was dropped in Hiroshima, you know, the Stalin came back to Moscow after a Potsdam Conference on August 5th. And August 5th, and he immediately resumed that the very frantic activities preparing for the war against Japan. And on August 6th, if you take a look at Stalin's logbook, there's an appointment. But I think that's, you know, the absence of appointment, I think, showed the extent of shock. And then August 6th, the 7th, the Japanese ambassador approached Soviet Foreign Ministry and says, "What about our request for mediation?" And immediately says, "The game is not up yet." And he immediately left to action. He ordered the military to resume to launch an attack 48 hours before that appointment upon time. And so he just managed to. And also immediately told Molotov to summon Sato, and Sato ambassador came to the foreign ministry, and Molotov said, "Sit down, we have very important news to tell you." And then he proceeded to read the declaration of war. And so the Soviets managed to join the war in the nick of time, totally fool the Japanese. And then, in a way that, therefore, Truman's expectation that the Japan would surrender with the shock of atomic bomb was betrayed. You have to understand that the history of the atomic bomb, that Manhattan project. Manhattan Project, under the directorship of General Groves, the military director, under him, there is a committee called the Target Committee. And early on, the target committee, sometime in April, I think before, sometime in May, they made a list. And also they discussed how to use the bomb. And they came to the conclusion that the bomb will be used against civilians and the cities. And in order to, this is, you know the term shock and awe strategy. This is the predecessor of shock and awe. This is very important to shock the Japanese government and the Japanese people. And that's the purpose. And in order to shock, it's not a military target. It's the civilians. We're going to just bomb as many, we're going to kill as many civilians, as many people as possible. And this is one bomb is not enough. You have to have a second bomb. And the second bomb so that we can convince the Japanese we have more. In fact, that the more would come, I think that the first bomb was used in New Mexico, right? Second bomb is used in Hiroshima. Third bomb was dropped in Nagasaki. And the fourth bomb was supposed to be available sometime in September. And so, you know, success by November the 1st, that's the U.S. Military was planning to have the Operation Olympic, that invasion, and then several bombs would have been ready to be dropped. And so this is the history of Manhattan Project. So that, you know, that the first bomb, the second bomb will be used consecutively in order to maximize the shock. And so the question is, what was the role of the president? The president and the others were not involved in all that, because in a very strange way, it's a sort of contradiction on atomic bomb. You know, there's a, it's already previous to atomic bomb, there's a strategic bombing, conventional incendiary bombs. And therefore, incendiary bomb particularly targeted against the civilians. And therefore, that killing civilians for the sake of for the military purpose was already accepted, and therefore, the very important threshold, moral threshold, already crossed. And therefore, that, you know, the killing, you know, killing with one bomb or 300 airplanes did not cross the mind of the. So this is not a, this is a decision. It was left on a decision of the local, I mean, the commanders, you know, yeah. Strategic Air Command. This is a very interesting point, because I think that sometimes something happened to Truman. Truman was convinced that it was okay, justified, because dropping a bomb was justified. And the Hiroshima bomb was justified. And then in August 9th, when the United States used the Nagasaki bomb, he made a statement to the effect that we use the bomb, so that we use the bomb against the enemy that did not, that the beat, that the captured or the attacked Pearl Harbor, and treated very brutally about against the prisoners of war, and so against, in violation of international law, right? And so that we do not regret using it against those brutal enemies, because the only language that they understand is the use of bomb. But on that day that he received the information, I think this is the first time he was confronted with the result of the Hiroshima bomb. More than 10,000 people just got bombed.
100,000.
I'm sorry, 100,000. 100,000 people were killed immediately. And that really, for the first time, he was confronted with this. And he said in a cabinet meeting that this is an awful bomb. And from now on, we are not going to authorize, you know, the use of the bomb unless that I give a permission. The decision, the timing is very important, because that when Nagasaki was the second bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, he had not received the first report of Hiroshima. That came only after Nagasaki bomb was dropped, and therefore that. Well, the question, of course, it really dawned on him what a terrible weapon it is. And I think, in my opinion, I think that the use of the bomb really bothered his conscience throughout his life. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it is very, very interesting because before he left office, there's lots of people are just working on his writing his presidency. And one of the men, trying to justify the drop in the Hiroshima bomb, because of this, Japanese savagery and so on. And he wrote a letter to him. He says, you know, the use of bomb was more terrible than the use of chemical weapons, biological weapons. And it's the implication of this is very important because chemical weapons and biological use of chemical weapons, biological weapons, is prohibited by the Hague Convention, right? And so that means in his mind, at least towards the end of his presidency, he was convinced the use of atomic bombs were actually against international law. And so that's a very interesting point. When you talk about the Japanese memory of the war, both Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they sort of blame that the United States government dropped the bomb. But you see, if the Japanese government had accepted surrender before Hiroshima, particularly after Hiroshima, right, and there would not have been second bomb. And I think Japanese government delay of surrender, I think, is a very, very important. I think that the Nagasaki people who suffered, you know, I think they are quite justified in blaming Japanese government. I think this is, again, this very interesting psychology of those people who developed the bomb, what, you know, it cost about $2 billion. Dallas, you know, U.S. Dallas, right? And that's at that time, that's an enormous expense. And so, of course, you know, they want to use the bomb and to see the effects. I think this is sort of mad scientist sort of experiment. You know, they are doing something frontier. And they want to see. I don't think that you can really deny that. And the other thing is that, what if all those politicians spent $2 billion and did not use it? And the American public, for instance, those people who were killed in an action, says, my gosh, you dropped the bomb and did not use it. I think so, and then also for Americans, for the sake of Americans as well, because this is something they did, and then unless that they really get into that, the reason why they used atomic bomb, then I think, in my opinion, it is connected with, say, the war against terrorism, terror. You know, it's just if the just war can justify the unjust method of fighting the war, then it is okay to use atomic bomb. It is used. It's okay to use torture. And so, unless you go back to that original decision, and really reflect on what the Americans said. This is, in my opinion, I think this is a war crime. If it's chemical warfare is a violation of international law, then atomic bomb is even worse than chemical warfare. And so, don't forget that it is not only that, you know, the number of people who are killed, but also radiation effects. People still, you know, suffering from radiation. And so that I think that it's for Americans to reflect on this and then really think about this is a matter of American conscience. I think this really touched the nerves of Americans, because most Americans know that atomic bomb was a terrible weapon, right? And they want to justify, and because that was the last alternative. There's no alternative but to use the bomb, therefore it can be justified. You know, it's another very interesting thing about the Japanese memory of the war is that, you know, it's very important turning point in Japanese history, right? But the process in which the Japanese government decided to terminate the war was not really closely scrutinized and closely studied. You know the reason why? The reason is because it'll touch on a very, very sensitive subject of Japanese history. That's the role of emperor. And this is still a taboo issue. And then therefore the Japanese historians don't touch it.